For decades, semiconductor fabs tolerated and in some cases even expected bad yields, less than 50% and even as low as 20 or 10%. Credible die yield data is rare, but here is an interesting market data analysis from the late 1980s prepared for the office of the U.S. Trade Representative during the U.S.-Japan semiconductor dispute. The analysis implies that when both American and Japanese memory makers started on 16K DRAM in 1978, their yields were about 2%, laughably low but expected. But yields stayed low for years. By 1984, data implied American 16K DRAM yield improved to just 36%. The Japanese had 48%, better but still bad. 6 years later. By the way, that 12% gap in yields accounts for an estimated 80% of the cost difference between Japan and the United States. Today, look at TSMC's N5/N4 process node, which is about 4 to 5 years old. Again, trade secrets, but N4 yields are around 80%. What's going on here? 6-micron process versus 4-nanometer, one is way harder to do. How are we hitting 80 to 90% yields with a 4-nanometer class node? Is it a conspiracy? The answer is that fabs opened their third eyes and with the help of some new tools started inspecting and improving. In this video, how automated inspection tools help revolutionize how chips are fabbed. But first, let me pitch a few things. First is the Patreon and the early access tier. It's the best way to directly support the channel, plus you get references. And second is the Asianometry letter/audio feed offered through the Stratechery Plus bundle. Listen to Ben Thompson, or as I call him, Ben Ben, and me. Two great offerings. Go check them out. Now back to the show. In the 1960s, wafer inspection involved humans literally looking at wafers through a microscope to find errors. The problem is that humans are made from flesh, and even if the spirit is willing, the flesh is weak and inconsistent. One study of human inspectors found that operators, even when given the same training, varied in effectiveness by a factor of 5. In any given shift, a human inspector's effectiveness starts off low, peaks about a third of the way into the shift, and then tails off. And throughout the entire shift, effectiveness never gets better than 87%. And to be fair to these poor workers, finding these defects was not fun. Particle defects, even back then, were often less than a micrometer large and barely visible with a microscope. Finding such tiny things on a big wafer at speed was a trying task. Last but not least, human inspection and classification of defects was subjective. It depended on that particular inspector's own judgment at that particular time. So defect data collected at one time cannot be compared to data from another time, giving no sense whether things were actually improving or not. The first automated inspection tools emerged in the 1970s, focusing not on wafers, but the mask. The photomask is a quartz glass template. It contains the master copy of the chip design to be printed onto wafers. So you can see the problem. With individual wafers, you do not have to catch every defect, but with a mask, you have to, because defects print. Automation makes a lot of sense. It takes a human some 4 to 20 hours to manually inspect a single 4-inch mask. If you're looking for a defect that is about 50 microinches large, which is about 1.27 micrometers, then that 4-inch mask has 6.4 billion discrete locations for you to inspect. Have fun. Misses were common. Studies found that 20% of inspected masks had false negatives, as in marked good, but in reality had a defect. They really are hard to see. So in the early 1970s, Bell Labs produced the first known automated mask inspection tool, named the AMIS. It compared two die images side by side using 2 3-micrometer wide laser beams. Deviations between the two images were flagged as possible defects. AMIS wasn't perfect. There were frequently misalignments due to mechanical issues. Temperature fluctuations can cause the mask to expand, creating false positives. It cannot detect repeated defects, determine if a defect is a fatal one, and it cannot detect a defect less than 2 micrometers large. But AMIS was nevertheless a breakthrough. Its long-term consistency let operators compare statistics across months or even years, informing them on whether their mask production processes were improving or not. AT&T's manufacturing arm, Western Electric, used the AMIS machine for several years. But being a Bell Labs thing, it was not available for sale. Another vendor would have to make something like it. KLA was founded in 1975 by Bob Anderson and Ken Levy. Levy entered the semiconductor business in an interesting way. A trained aerospace engineer, he first joined a flight simulation company, but soon left with two of his managers for a company called Computer Vision. Computer Vision originally was going for computer-aided design, the phrase back then for what we now call EDA software, and in fact, they later became one of the industry's first-generation Big Three alongside Applicon and Calma. But as it worked on that business, Computer Vision needed some cash flow. So the company decided to make and sell semiconductor manufacturing equipment as a side gig. I would have sold apple pies or lemonade at the street corner, but they wanted to do the easy thing, I guess. So they bought a small invention that helped for lithography. It automatically aligned a wafer with the photomask so that you can properly expose it. Sounds easy, but this was not a trivial task, and operators used to have to use microscopes to do it. Levy led the effort to turn this little invention into a product, buying a mechanics company in California named Koblet to help. Koblet became a good-sized semiconductor equipment business, employing 350, making alignment machines, developers, photoresist coders, and more. Computer Vision clearly did not care for the business despite it contributing 40% of revenue at its peak. And after spending so much time in California, Levy caught the startup bug. He pitched to the CFO at Computer Vision on their own thing, and in 1975 the two left to raise $600K of VC money for KLA. With Levy gone, Computer Vision started selling off Koblet's various equipment lines. The strong wafer probe and coder/developer products were first packed off to Tokyo Electron, and the rest was later acquired by Jim Morgan over at Applied Materials. In 1978, KLA launched their first product, the KLA-100. It was an automatic photomask inspection system that crawled a laser across a mask and recorded the reflection. The 100 not only provided a more thorough, rigorous inspection, but also cut inspection times from 8 hours to as little as 5 minutes for a 3-inch mask. Later systems like the KLA-200 series, released in the early 1980s, added the ability to compare a mask image to a reference image stored in a database. These early automated mask inspection tools showed fab operators that their actual wafer defect densities were far worse than previously thought. But the tools also showed them a way forward. Now, if tools can let you find and categorize wafer defects, then we can systematically either rework the wafers or remove the cause of the defect. In 1984, KLA released the KLA-2020. The KLA-2020 was the first of its type, an automated pattern wafer inspection tool working right on the wafer production line. Such a tool is referred to as being in line. At its heart, the KLA-2020 is an automated, illuminated high-speed camera with a microscope attached. The camera takes pictures of the wafer at varying magnifications as defined by pixel sizes of widths 10 microns, 2 microns, etc. The computer then compares those images to that of a neighboring die to find defects and report them to the operator. They use a variety of image processing algorithms to do this, the most common being a simple subtraction of one image from the other. The KLA-2020 is called a bright field tool. The name refers to how it provides light for those photographs. A light source illuminates the die to make it easier to view the die's features. The images come out quite nice. Fabs do inspections at certain critical points in the process flow, like, for example, lithography. In lithography, there is an exposure tool that exposes the resist-coated wafer with UV light. Then the wafer is quote-unquote developed to harden the resist and prepare it for the etch step. Etch is where we use the hardened resist to guide and cut into the substrate. Since etch is permanent, it is prudent to first inspect the exposed wafer to find any defects like bridges or gaps in the design patterns, and also check whether the alignment meets spec. Yamagata NEC Corporation published a rare case study detailing how their KLA 2020 inspector tool performed in an inspection step after an aluminum etch step as compared to human inspectors. Their study concluded that the machine was 5 times faster and 10 times better at catching defects than a human. Automated inline inspections by KLA 2020 tool and others like it made it possible for fabs to continually monitor how their wafers are doing. When the inspection tool finds something wrong, operators can be alerted as soon as possible so that they can pull the wafer from its normal flow and maybe send it back for rework. Or alternatively, they can trace the defect. At TSMC, there is a video of every wafer. During defect review, they will pull all the data and look through the video of the dead wafer to find out what happened in the hope of eliminating the defect source altogether. These early tools were definitely not perfect. One problem was that not all wafer deviations are important enough to be killer defects. If tool operators did not set the proper filters, then the tool will flood them with a bunch of false alarms. But the biggest complaint was that the KLA 2020 was so slow. Its inspection rate was just 0.1 100mm wafers per hour. So in practice, operators pull samples out of wafer lots for inspection, like a sort of tasting the air. KLA was not alone in the field. Other tools entered the space to fill certain niches. Another tool that came out at the same time as the KLA 2020 was the 10-core 7000. The 10-core tool was used for inspecting a surface's physical characteristics via something called dark field illumination. Dark field involves firing a laser at a surface and examining the scattered light. Particles on the surface will scatter the laser light in ways we can detect. It does not give you the same detail as bright field illumination, but it is cheaper and faster on throughput. In 1997, KLA and Tencore merged in a blockbuster $1.2 billion deal. It created the giant KLA Tencore, which is now just KLA Corporation in California. Today, they are one of the big semiconductor manufacturing equipment companies with a $100 billion market cap. As I mentioned earlier, one of the biggest issues of these first generation of wafer inspectors was throughput, so tool makers added new features to speed these tools up. In the 1990s, tool makers added faster computers to the tools to let them do faster image processing and other things like comparing the wafer with a stored data file of the chip design. And then in the 2000s, they made a major transition away from old charge-coupled devices, CCDs, for taking the images and adopted CMOS image sensors. This helped the tools take images much faster and opened the door to digital processing. They also changed their light sources. KLA later adopted broadband plasma, or BBP. With this, a laser is used to ignite a plasma so to generate an intense broadband light, as in covering a broad range of wavelengths from visible light to UV. KLA emphasizes that the key metric for their inspectors isn't resolution. They aren't making lithography machines that have to pattern very tiny things, but rather contrast or signal to noise. They want the defect to be visible, and tuning the illumination to different wavelengths can help a defect stand out more. In recent years, KLA has been introducing inspection with deep UV wavelengths as a way to capture even smaller defects, maybe as small as 10 nanometers. I await the day they start blasting tin with lasers. Today, KLA remains the leader with a strong grip on the high end of the inspection market. That is generally described as inspection tools operating in the front end of the line, as in the sexy wafer fabrication stuff with the clean fabs and all that. These require more intense magnification and stricter cleanliness, so they command a higher price. Along with KLA, you might have Applied Materials and Hitachi High-Tech as minor players in the high end as well. Tools on the lower end of the industry spectrum tend to operate in the back end of the line. So processes that happen after the wafer fabrication is done. Assembly, test, packaging and such, mostly packaging. The cleanliness requirements for such tools tend to be more lenient, and so the tools tend to command a lower price. For example, we have the company Rudolph Technologies, which entered the inspector tool space from microscopes. Their tool looks at the bumps, redistribution layers, and TSVs that are characteristic of packaging slash advanced packaging. In 2019, Rudolph merged with Nanometrics to create Onto Innovation, a publicly traded company. I find the name peculiar. Onto and another company called Camtek are probably the most familiar players in the low end of the automated optical inspection tool industry. In total, the whole industry is probably worth around $5 to $8 billion. I want to thank Ben M. for suggesting this topic and also patiently walking me through this industry, one I walked into with little knowledge. The chips are still getting smaller, and as they do, the definition of a defect continues to get stricter. Such things make the jobs of the inspection tools that much harder. One of the interesting things to look forward to in the industry is expanding the use of AI for identifying and classifying defects. With AI, you might not even need a reference image to flag and categorize a defect down the line. It would just know. But Intel, TSMC, Samsung, and other fabs are deeply conservative companies. Their process nodes tend to go on for years on end, and they are afraid of changing things even if it might seem to bring some benefits. I get their perspective. The art of yield management is a long, slow slog. Behind that simple, improving yield curve are the accumulated efforts of tens of thousands of workers inspecting, troubleshooting, and fixing defects on the line. A technical miracle made from the combination of fast-moving microscopes and good old blood, sweat, and tears. Alright everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.